I want to thank the organizers for putting this workshop together. It's been really helpful to me so far. And also want to take this opportunity to thank the folks at ASU and APL for putting together really nice, easy-to-use, straightforward products and tools that really make my life so much easier. So my goal for today is to demonstrate how primarily JMARS can be used to address a particular science problem, also a little bit Da Vinci as well. And the science that I'm interested in lately is if you look in the nighttime radiance data from the Venus instrument, you find hundreds of these high thermal inertia exposures in the plains, but also on the crater floors. And because they're high thermal inertia, they are rocky surfaces. They're less covered with sediment. And if you look at them in spectral data or a Venus false color image, you can see that there are color differences in the IR, which indicates that there are spectral differences that correspond to the high thermal inertia units. And so this has been the subject of study by myself and Christopher Edwards and a few others. And if you go to start looking at the details, when you start looking at these high thermal inertia units, you can see that within the bedrock units themselves, there are spectral variations. So hopefully you can see that there's some blue areas and then some red areas in this false color Venus image. And so this kind of science requires really high resolution, detailed analyses with multiple data sets. By the way, I think this is probably multiple igneous lithologies located in these areas. And so you need to be able to understand the compositional differences between those units and the ages. Some of the measurements you needed are compositional assessments, the geographical extent of units, stratigraphy and thicknesses of units. And so today's objective is to demonstrate the tools in workflow for making some of these measurements. I'm going to skip over some of this because it's already been covered. JMARS is a great tool for finding data, so that's the first thing. You can load pretty much any stamp layer that you want. This shown here is high-rise data coverage, and then prism stamps in blue. On the next slide, I'm showing Venus daytime IR images. By the way, the background here is Venus nighttime radiance. So this is one of those rocky exposures, and the red lines now are showing Venus daytime IR. And so if you want to get a quick look at what the daytime spectral data are showing you, you can right-click on any stamp of interest. By the way, right-clicking brings up a lot of functionality in JMARS that you might not realize is there. Also, shift-clicking and alt-clicking as well. So you right-click, you can see a couple options here. View Venus stamps. You see all the stamp IDs that are here, and then you can go and say, oh, I want to render one of these, and you can pick a number of pre-generated decorrelation stretch combos that are already there. So I click 875. And now JMARS is displaying the decorrelation stretch image. So I didn't have to do anything other than right-click and click render, and it's already there. I didn't have to do any processing of my own. And you can see by looking at these images that the color differences give you some indication that there's some spectral differences there. Now to really understand what's the shape of those differences or what the spectra look like, you actually have to download the image and do the atmosphere correction and that sort of thing. And I won't go into detail for that because it takes a long time to explain, but this is a good starting point. And you can imagine that you'd be able to start doing some mapping on these rendered images, and you can render multiple images. You do the same thing with prism. So now I'm going to show you here, you right click on a prism stamp here. This color here is the Venus IR data that's been rendered. Now I want to see what prism has to say. So I right click, and there's a stamp. And there's a couple of rendering options. There's APL images, which are from the PDS, and I'll show you that in a second. And then there's ASU images, and I'll explain the differences between these in a second. So you can select your favorite summary parameter, and it will be rendered within JMARS. So now you have all these multiple layers. You can click them on and off. You can make them transparent to see what corresponds with what. And here I'm showing all of the index 2 that was calculated by ASU. And so you can say, oh, okay, there's some differences here in all of the abundance, possibly. And let me explain what these different rendering options are. The ASU images are individual summary parameters. So it's a single summary parameter. It's generated at ASU. The formulations are mostly from Palki et al. 2007, but some of them might have been slightly altered, for example, averaging a couple of bands instead of using a single band or band up. And the stretches are based on statistics from each scene. Contrast that with the prism RGB composites that are available from the PDS, so you could use from the PDS. Same thing formulations are the same, but now these are three different summary parameters loaded as an RGB composite. So here I'm showing the MASIC brown sporadic, in which alamine is red, HCP is blue, and LCP is green. These are different types of purine compositions. And the stretches here are based on preset values that are, I guess, defined based on global strength in alamine and HCP and LCP. These both have their advantages. I like to use both. This one tells you, okay, there might be more alamine in one area versus the other, but it doesn't really give you a sense of how much alamine is here compared to the rest of the planet. Whereas if something shows up red in one of these products, it indicates, okay, this is a relatively strong alamine absorption compared to the rest of the planet. So it's helpful to use both based on the different types of stretches that they have. The JMARS test layer, if this had existed when I was doing my PhD, I would have finished 6 months earlier. It's a wonderful product. You can go here to Spectra and click test, and it will download, or it'll grab all the test spectra in a particular query. So you can go here to predefined templates, and so there's some that are already there that you can start with. You can modify it how you want. It's basically a GUI-based query to the test vanilla database. And so when you click one of those, this is what pops up. You see a place where you can enter fields and a place where you can enter selects. The fields are what you want returned. For example, emissivity, target temperature, and the selects say, how do you want to constrain that return data? So I only want target temperatures above 260 Kelvin or something like that, or dust capacities that are low, or local time. So you do that, and then now you can see all these red squares here are footprints from individual test spectra. And so this gives you an idea of where you have test coverage, and for example, if you want to know what does the test spectrum look like from this particular area, you can click on it, and over here, your emissivity spectra will pop up here, and you can start to get an idea of how different these different units are. You can't see it here, but you can, the footprints you click on are actually outlined in these red, white polygons. So I actually like to make screen captures of these so I can keep track of where I pulled test data from for a given area. One note that the footprints are drawn actually is 3 by 3 kilometer squares, but the actual footprint is probably closer to 3 by 8 kilometers. So it's a pretty good approximation, but you have to use care when you're interpreting these footprints on unit boundaries. And then of course you can export your emissivity spectra to ASCII and open it with DaVinci or Excel or whatever you want. Or as Chris was saying before, they're working on towards streamlining that with DaVinci. Another thing I want to point out that not many people know about, but there are these predefined spectral indices that have been published in the literature. Each one of these is basically like prism summary parameters, but it maps something different. So for example, 465 index from Ruffin Christensen maps high silica material, so you can map that full test resolution. And what it does is it calculates the indices on the fly. So here you can see this 530 index is channel 40 divided by the average of channel 36 and 37. So what I'm showing here is the distribution, the relative strength of a test 530 index overlaying on this venous nighttime rating. So you don't even have to do an atmospheric correction in some cases with these indices. You can start to get a pretty good sense of what's going on with the composition without having to go into the full atmospheric correction. And here's another example. This is another index that I generated with JMARS. And so this is showing basically differences in composition. I won't go into it. Another thing that JMARS is great for is mapping. So they have a shape layer where you can actually draw polygons or points or lines. These are polygons that I drew based on the previous index map. So wherever you see a high area, I drew a polygon around it. And so you make these nice maps, you can export it to ArcGIS. You can also import ESRI shape files as well, if you want to share with your colleagues who like ArcGIS better. You can do basic calculations, so you can calculate perimeter area. So for example, the total area for all these polygons is 165,000 square kilometers, which was something I need to know for the science that I was doing here. You can also do map sampling with these polygons. So for example, you can say find the average or the maximum thermal inertia value for every single polygon and output to an ASCII table. Same thing with mole elevations. Basically any numeric map that you have, you can sample these polygons. This is distribution of these high thermal inertia deposits, by the way. One Jim already covered this, you can do spatial profiles, or molecular profiles. Crater counting is something that's been implemented, I think, in the last couple of years, and I just started using it. It's really nice. You click 3 points, and it'll fit a circle to those 3 points. You click 3 points around the rim of the crater, and it'll make a circle, and it'll record the diameter. And then you just export that list to crater stats or whatever your favorite crater counting tool is. So it's really been useful. We're using this to start to try to derive the ages of some of these deposits, especially the larger ones. Okay, now the only thing that JMARS really can do is spectral analysis of FEMIS prism data. So for that, you'd have to go and download your image and import it into DaVinci or Envy to do the analyses. This just shows the general workflow that I would do. I would select my images using JMARS, and I would process them using this FEMIS processing tool that I don't have time to talk about, but it's a web-based processing tool. Then load it into DaVinci to actually pull out spectra. I want to point you to this website. Here you can find presentations from the 2005 FEMIS Data Users Workshop. This is a list of them here. These really go into good detail about how you do the atmospheric correction in DaVinci, step by step, and it gives examples. There's a lot of effort put into making these presentations really nice, so go there if you want to know how to get started with the atmospheric correction of the FEMIS data. You can get to this point. You know, this is a VCS emissivity image from one of these rocky surfaces. You can see spots of red and blue. These are different lithologies, I think, based on the FEMIS spectrum. Here I've extracted emissivity spectra. These are atmospherically corrected. Unfortunately, I don't have time, but you can see that there are differences here. And there are also differences apparent in the prism data, which I showed earlier. So it's really great to be able to integrate these different products using JMARS, and then you just pop out to the CAT tool or to DaVinci to do your detailed spectral analysis. I'm not going to go through this, but this is a list of some of the functions you could use if you wanted to do the atmospheric correction in DaVinci, so you can come back to this on the web presentations. One of the things that we also use with DaVinci a lot is this spectral mixture analysis tool. You can do deconvolution of test spectra. This is how we try to estimate mineral abundances based on the test spectral character. And here's some example uses that you can come back to and look at here. And then I have some references of the various things that I just talked about where you can go for more data. That's all.